Well, we have Roy again here, and I think now he will, from what he told me before, I think now you're going to get the most thorough understanding on the basic nonlinear optics process that lead to ultra-fast phenomena, supercontinuum generation. So maybe you connect some of the stuff that you've been hearing, like from other professors now after Roy's courses. Okay, and just one advice, I'm gonna ask you guys to check your email by noon, because I'm gonna email you with the list of people that we already have the reimbursement ready to go. So this is about 30 people. I have we have the checks ready, so we don't clutch everybody on Simone's door. So we got the groups, and afternoon she's gonna have another 30, and probably later that afternoon we're gonna get another 30 checks, and we keep going like that, so you can get your reimbursement. And if you have if you took a bus from Guarulhos Airport to Campinas, it is possible to reimburse you as well, provided you kept your little receipt. So when you go for picking your check, tell Ms. Simone that you have your receipt, and she'll prepare another round of reimbursement, but that will be done in cash, just because it's a small value, so it's easier. So next, somewhere later in the week, we're going to just give you, if you have the receipt kept with you, we're going to just give you a cash corresponding to that value, okay?
Okay.
Please, Roy.
Right. Okay, well, good morning, everyone. It's really nice to see you. I appreciate you turning up. I wouldn't turn up to hear me at half eight in the morning. I definitely wouldn't. And none of our students in London ever would either. Okay, so what I want to do is I want to talk about ultrafast fiber-based nonlinearity. And the main reason for this is to explain really how supercontinuum processes take place, and also some of the processes that are used and the lasers that are used actually to produce this. The other thing I want to point out is that that a lot of the supercontinuum sources that are now extensively used and are bought and are commercialized and are used as pump sources, what I want you to get away from my talk is that really a lot of them aren't what they appear to be, and they aren't particularly good sources of pulses, and there are some problems with them. And I'll show you some alternative mechanisms to generate the colors or whatever the wavelengths that you may need. So just before I start, I would really like to say how nice it is to be here again. I first came to Campinas in 1990. It's really nice of Gustavo to invite me here, and it's a pleasure to be here and to be able to interact with you. I know sometimes people don't want to ask questions, and that's no problem. After the talk, please come and talk to me outside and ask anything. I don't care what you ask. I don't care what it is. Just if you have a question you want to ask me, want to ask in private, no problem at all. I'm here for the next few days, so please feel free and come and see me anytime. Okay? So let's get started. So this is just a very, very quick outline of what I'll talk about. The real advantage is that Paolo and Philip and Sid have actually covered a lot of the stuff that I wanted to talk about, so I'll be able to skip through it quite quickly, but I'll give you an introduction here of what is going to happen. And the other thing is that I'm not going to actually rely on lots of formulas and stuff. What I want to actually do is explain this in a more qualitative way, so that you get a feel what's done experimentally and what you do and how these processes actually take place. Okay, so I'll just give a quick introduction to what it is. Then I'll go through some of the basic nonlinear processes. And then I'll talk about how these are associated with supercontinuum generation and the development of supercontinuum sources. And then how actually the nonlinear processes are actually controlled. Then really the underlying thing is the technology. It's the technology. There's actually zero new physics in any of this. There isn't one new physical nonlinear process that's been invented in the last 20 years. It's all been known. It's the technology that's driven all of this. And that's and so it's, what's the improving technology? What are the fibers? What are the lasers? Then extending the palette, just actually what new wavelengths, what ranges can you cover? And really I want to talk then, clearly I talk about the limitations of these sources and what the alternatives are, what you can use that are maybe cheaper than a $50,000 super continuum source. And then some summary, but really in a way it's up to you to make your own conclusions. You're here at a summer school, you have to think about things, you know, you think, is this a waste of time anyway? Okay, so we saw this the other night. So really there's nothing to say. The laser was invented and you can get short pulses from it, and that's basically it. And this happened quite quickly. The thing to sort of get from that is that if you have something like, say, a microjoule pulse with a picosecond duration, and you focus that down to a 5-micron spot, typically so you can focus that into, say, an optical fiber, the power density is about a terawatt per square centimeter, which is enormous. And that means you have electric fields of the order of about 10 to the 6 to 10 to the 7 volts per centimeter. And this is enormous as well. So atoms or molecules are definitely going to respond to that, and they're not going to respond in a linear way, they're going to respond in a non-linear way. And this is, Paolo covered this and Sid covered this as well. And so you just simply think of that sort of distortion in the linear case, you just have the polarizations directly proportional to the electric field through the susceptibility. And that susceptibility essentially defines your conventional refractive index. So once this electric field starts to become big, then you have to think of all the higher order terms. Just expand the polarization in terms of these higher order susceptibilities. Again, what Sid looked at and told you, even higher terms were considered. Now these terms here are really, really small, very small. But the E's are quite big, so that makes up for it. And so these terms here start to become quite significant. And as you heard yesterday, if you have materials that have that are centrosymmetric, i.e. a piece of fused quartz or something like that, then you get no chi 2 term. That's not to say that you can't get second harmonic in fibers. You can. But conventionally, you don't consider chi 2 terms in centrosymmetric materials. And so the first term that sort of begins to dominate, and the one that's of the sort of most importance is this chi 3 term. And it's the one that leads on to, say, for example, the nonlinear refractive index, Raman scattering, four-wave mixing, or whatever. And these are important processes, all in the generation of, say, for example, supercontinuum. Now, one of the things really to point out was that nonlinear optics didn't begin with the laser. There was a lot of nonlinear optics done before the laser came along. And for example, Kerr in 1875 looked at isotropic media, so he wasn't going to see any chi 2 processes. But he was looking at the birefringence induced in materials when you applied a DC electric field. Now, the field was applied externally. He actually applied an electric field to materials. And so the change, the birefringence induced, was actually proportional to E squared. And the whole thing, of course, then is described by a third-order nonlinear susceptibility. But only one of the fields here is actually supplied by the light. It's the external field, the electric field that he was applying, that was giving this change in birefringence. And of course, Pockels, 1895, looking at piezoelectric crystals, okay, these are birefringent crystals, they aren't centrosymmetric. And by applying a DC field, he could see a polarization proportional to the applied field and the optical field, so in terms in E squared. And this is the kind of term then that gives rise to either sum or difference frequency generation. So the laser didn't invent nonlinear optics. Nonlinear optics was well underway before the laser, but suddenly it became quite easy. And, of course, Sid once again pointed out the first reported laser-driven nonlinear optical process was second harmonic generation. And just out of interest, Sid, of course, told you that Gabby Weinreich actually corrected Frank, and Franken had the idea of actually doing it in essentially fused quartz. And he had spoken to Weinreich, who was actually a material scientist, and he thought about it overnight and contacted him and said, no, it's not going to work, but it will if you use crystal quartz. The other thing that is interesting is the guy, Peters, was actually on this paper because actually he supplied the spectrograph that the measurement was taken on. The really, really important thing is that the guy who did actually all the work was Alan Hill. And this guy was a student. He was an undergraduate student. But he was exceptionally good, and he took all the results. The other thing that I find remarkable in this work is that, in fact, the ruby laser that they used was a rented ruby laser. It was actually a commercial laser. And this was 1961. This was just 1 year after the laser was invented. And in the States, it shows you what innovation is like. This was actually a commercial laser that was rented to them. I think it's fantastic. The other thing, of course, that's really nice is that this is actually, this plate here is a reproduction taken from the original magazine. I copied this from the magazine at Imperial, from PhysRev Letters. And the caption underneath it reads, a reproduction of the first plate in which there is unambiguous indication of second harmonic generation at 3.472 angstroms, shown in figure one. This is figure one. So this is around 6.94, which is everybody knows is the ruby wavelength. And here you go along to 3.472, and you can see unambiguous evidence, can't you? And actually, what is actually said was that in these days you send a plate, you actually send a photograph to the magazine, and the people that were at the magazine thought that the small smudge was actually a defect and removed it from the photograph. And that's why it was published with no second harmonic that was unambiguously shown. Okay, that's just an aside of how things can go wrong in nonlinear optics. So, if you look at nonlinear optics and you want to think of the power and the use of the fiber, well, nonlinear optics is really just power times length. And all you do is you focus down into your crystal and you have this confocal parameter, which is simply given by this W squared, where W is the waist, divided by the wavelength, essentially. Now, if you look at using bulk materials, the sort of best you can do, say, if you're going to focus down to, say, 5, 10 microns, is really a Rayleigh length here of about a centimeter, roughly a centimeter. You can do a bit better, but roughly a centimeter is an order of magnitude. If, however, you go along to a fiber, you focus down into the fiber with the same sort of 5-micron diameter, and you manage to get it into the fiber, well, in actual fact, it will guide then for the length of the fiber, and the only thing that will limit you will be the loss. Now, the loss of optical fibers is tremendous these days, 0.1 dB per kilometer, better than that. And so that means that you can propagate in this for 10 kilometers or more before the loss becomes any problem. So the choice is, can you do it over 10 kilometers or 1 centimeter? So clearly you have an enhancement there of about a million times to 10 million times. So of course, by doing nonlinear optics and fiber, you can reduce the power by a million times and still see the effect. Okay? So that's the big, big advantage of using fiber. There's lots of disadvantages, but that's one advantage. But then, of course, there are other problems. It's not just that you get it into the fiber and it stays there forever. There's dispersion. So if you're using pulses, you're going to have the problem of dispersion. And this seems quite trivial. And in fibers, well, in fact, it's the frequency depends on the phase velocity gives you this dispersion. And in an optical fiber, the dispersion really arises out of several things. Of course, the main contribution is the material dispersion. Quartz, silicon. You have a contribution due to the waveguide, so the shape of the waveguide really will affect the dispersion. So if you have something with a depressed cladding, you can see that effectively the evanescent wave here sees a different refractive index, so it's going to propagate differently than this one. So the waveguide, the shape affects the fiber, so you have waveguide dispersion. You, of course, have modal dispersion, where you have different modes, and they'll occupy different sort of regions of space of the waveguide. But here we'll only consider All the stuff that we do is essentially single mode. So we'll ignore mode dispersion the whole time. But you have all these three contributions. So you have to then look at dispersion. So if you take the wave number and sort of expand it, and the wave number, this is this just sort of change in phase per unit length, and you expand that about some sort of central wavelength, then you get sort of a cascade of terms of first, second, third order. And this is just some sort of like fixed permanent phase offset. This first term here, really, that just simply results in a delay overall of the pulse. It's essentially the group velocity. So the envelope is moving and you can see the delay in it. The one that sort of is kind of serious is this second order term, and this gives rise to interpulse dispersion or group velocity dispersion. And usually the most convenient way to describe this is in the engineering term, which is in units of picosecond per nanometer kilometer, Philip actually mentioned. And it's given by this sort of term here, which this is the beta 2 minus 2 pi c of lambda squared. It's very, very confusing as well. And I lots of students, and even I get confused at times because you listen to people talking when they're talking about negative dispersion. You don't know what they're talking about. I actually like the term anomalous and normal. That sort of clarifies it, and you can sort of see. So if beta 2 is positive, D, the group delay dispersion, is negative, but you're in the normal dispersion regime. So I'll simply talk about normal dispersion and anomalous dispersion here throughout the whole lecture. And so if you look at, say, for example, a typical silica fiber, this is a sort of early fiber. Above about 1.3, you have anomalous dispersion, and below that, you have normal dispersion. And for silica-based fibers with a conventional structure, sort of step index, then the minimum that you can achieve is about 1.27 microns. You can't get anomalous dispersion below 1.27 in a silica-based standard conventional fiber. So just to give you a hands-on, and I'm sure many of you are very aware of this, this is just looking at the dispersion of different types of pulses, just a straightforward, very simple calculation. If you have 100 picosecond transform limited pulse, it'll have a bandwidth at 1 micron of about 0.16 nanometers. If you put that into 100 meters of fiber with a dispersion of about 50 picoseconds per nanometer kilometer, the broadening is 0.08 picoseconds. So that's the input and the output pulse. And essentially, you can see no change. Effectively, there's no change. So this would be fantastic for doing your nonlinear optics over 100 meters of fiber, as long as you weren't worried about other things. So there's no dispersion, there's no drop in the intensity at all. If you put in a picosecond pulse, on the other hand, it'll have a bandwidth of about 100 times bigger than this. So over 100 meters with this dispersion, it'll broaden by up to eight picoseconds. So you can clearly see now that the intensity's dropped by an order of magnitude in propagating through the fiber. So your nonlinear effect at the back end is definitely not going to be the same as it was at the front, and totally changing throughout the whole propagation. Well, you can imagine it gets worse then with femtosecond pulses. If you start doing it with femtosecond pulses, forget about 100 meters. This is a femtosecond pulse, and only after 2 meters of transform limit 100 femtosecond pulse, the pulse is broadened by an order of magnitude. So dispersion clearly is a killer in these fibers. Of course, there are mechanisms to overcome the problem of dispersion. We'll talk about those. So if we just quickly cascade through the nonlinearity, so as you have in your mind what's happening in the fiber and how it affects the actual radiation in the fiber. The first sort of nonlinearity that we'll talk about, it was really recognized by Shimizu in 1967, and it's a result of the intensity-dependent refractive index, so which comes through the Chi3 term. So for silica, this nonlinear refractive index, probably the lowest of any material. you can get 3 × 10⁻²⁰ meters squared per watt. But once again, it's the intensity that's the thing that puts it on. So if you look very, very simply, if you have a phase change, in the refractive index times the wave number times the length that you propagate over. So delta N is just N2I times K times L, but you know that a change in phase with time is a frequency change. So delta omega is minus d phi by dt, so you just take the straight derivative in time with this. These, of course, are all constants. So the change in frequency is simply the time derivative of the intensity. So what does that look like? And this is actually assuming an instantaneous response. In silica, the response is of the order of femtoseconds, a few femtoseconds. So essentially, it is nominally instantaneous. So if you take the differential of this, then you have this sweep here with a linear sweep in the center. It's frequency downshift at the front, so it becomes red at the front, blue at the back. And this happens throughout the pulse. Of course, if you have a put it into material with a time response, then what you'll have is like the delta N will sort of lag this in time and then die off in time. So you can see if there's a time response in this, you'll probably have a big red response and a small blue response in the back end of that. So you'll have this big red shift. But everything that we talk about here is primarily in silica. We assume it's instantaneous. And it'll have this instantaneous. This was actually seen by Ippen first, and in fact, Eric looked at it in hollow core fiber using the material that Sid mentioned, carbon disulfide, and he looked at self phase modulation in a hollow core silica filled, carbon disulfide filled fiber. And then Roger Stoll and Chenlong Lin looked at it in a solid core fiber. So what does it look like? This is what it looks like theoretically. As you take a 50-meter fiber, take a gamma, the nonlinear coefficient of the fiber, and you simply have the input, then you increase the power from 10, 100 to a kilowatt, you see this broadening, this spectral broadening modulation in it. And experimentally, this is what happens in 200 meters of fiber with, and this is logarithmic, this is linear response. This 200 meters of fiber, 90 picosecond pulses, 50 watts peak power, relatively low peak power, and you see this spectral broadening that happens with the pulses. And this would be going in from a transform limited spectrum. So you have essentially a spectral broadening. And that's happening in the time domain. As Sid pointed out yesterday, of course, you can get it spatially. And that simply is, once again, it's the intensity-dependent refractive index. There's more intensity in the peak of the pulse, so this is retarded in time. The wings are traveling faster, so this folds in on itself, collapsing on itself, essentially self-focusing. One of the big problems also that occurred in very early amplifier systems was that you could actually have little phase perturbations or intensity perturbations across the beam. So if you looked at the sort of beam itself, you would see little micro-type intensity fluctuations, essentially noise on the beam. And these cells then can act as their own little sources for self-focusing, particularly if this is an amplified beam. And so this was usually a catastrophic occurrence in amplifier change. You'd get this self-focusing filamentation, and it would blow up the amplifier, and you'd have a series of actually bubbles through the rod that would actually destroy the material. And there was no going back from that. Once it had happened, it was written off. That was the end of it. Okay, well, the other process, four-wave mixing, and this was first recognized in fiber by Hill, although they called it three-wave mixing in the first paper, primarily because they were using the semi-degenerate case where two of the pumps are the same wavelength. But the most common cases you've heard earlier in the week is this where you have two pumps and signal and idler coming out. And of course, this has to be conservation of energy, has to give this that the pump energy has to equal whatever comes. And of course, the other thing you need to have is this conservation of momentum. And that means if you sum these up, you have to have some sort of, it actually has to come to zero. And this delta K, which is the phase mismatch, which is met by the material and the waveguide dispersion, has to be equal to zero. So it has to be phase matched, which is the problem. So most generally, as I say, you use two pumps of the same wavelength. Now, one of the problems, of course, is that in single mode fibers, this phase matching can't be achieved in solely the normal dispersion regime. You can't achieve this in the normal dispersion regime. So what happens is that you either have to go to multi-mode operation where different modes can actually give you a different the phase matching. Alternatively, which is easier, is actually to operate around the dispersion zero where everything's very, very nearly zero dispersion anyway, and you can match it quite easily. And the other thing I want to remind you of is that even if you do this, the other thing is that you have the intensity-dependent refractive index. So as you change the pump intensity, you're going to be changing the phase of your pump beam, so you're going to change your phase matching conditions. So as you change the pump power, you change the phase matching condition as well. So this is a consideration that you have to think of if you're doing something like four-wave mixing. And what does that look like? Well, this is once again back to the conventional standard fiber with a zero around 1.3. This is just an ordinary sort of telecom type fiber. And you calculate your phase matching term. This is the phase matching curve that you'll achieve for this fiber. The zero of the dispersion is here, about 1.317, 315. And what you can see is that if you want to achieve phase matching, you're pumping, well, you have to be pumping in the normal dispersion regime. Okay, so you're pumping here in the normal dispersion regime. And so your Stokes and your anti-Stokes, your signal and idler, will be at 1.5, which is in the anomalous regime. And that's phase matched with the signal here about 1.15, your anti-Stokes. Now, one of the things, primarily this edge is determined quite strongly by the actual material dispersion. You can change the shape of this by changing the waveguide. The other thing to notice is that you aren't really going to get too far down into the visible using this technique. Because if you look, this is actually heading up quite quickly to about 2 microns. Roughly above 2 microns in a standard fibers, you're going to have loss. And so you can see that really 2 microns is going to be sitting up here. This is not going to allow you to generate 600 nanometers, 500 nanometers. So using conventional fibers, this sort of technique won't allow you to generate visible. The other non-linearity is stimulated Raman scattering. Well, once again, you heard about Raman scattering, and this process is just using optical phonons, and this shows the Stokes process here. You pump, essentially, to a virtual state, scatter off that virtual state, and the excess energy is taken up by the optical phonon. It was actually, and this process is, this is the spontaneous process. As you increase the intensity, you can stimulate the process, and so you can achieve gain. And this was first observed by Woodbury and Nee. I think that's how you pronounce it. And in 1970. And it was, like all good discoveries, it was totally accidental. They were trying to actually Q-switch a ruby laser. And they used a saturable absorber in a liquid, I think it was dichloridium. And what they noticed is that when they looked at the output of their laser, they had the, it did Q-switch, of course. They had the 6943 of the ruby laser. And then they saw what they thought was a new line in ruby lying up around 700 nanometers. And they thought that this was a new process that was happening in ruby. But in fact, it was stimulated Raman. So they pumped at the ruby laser wavelength, it scattered off the dichloroethane, and this was the result and red wavelength, 700 nanometers. Eric Ippen once again looked at it for the first time in fiber, and once again in hollow core fiber filled with liquid. And first all fiber system was done by Roger Stolen. And what you'll find throughout the whole history of optical fibers and nonlinearity, you probably find that Roger Stolen was one of the first guys to do it. If it wasn't done in Diano's lab, it was done by Roger Stolen. So you know, that's quite often what happened. And this is the gain profile that you will get from silica. Now, as distinct from most people think of Raman scattering, they're thinking of looking at processes of beautiful crystals. We have lovely, nice, sharp peaks and stuff like that. Here, remember, this is a glass. So the silicon dioxide is all over the place. It's not a regular structure. They form little rings that sort of flex and vibrate. And the little peaks on this actually correspond to different flexion and flexures and vibrations in the glass. And it's very, very broad simply because it's a glassy structure. You don't have a regular structure. So the sort of central frequency of the vibrations are broadened out. So this is very, very broad. So stimulated scattering, the thing important about it is it's present in all fibers. It's a non-elastic process, so energy is lost. You know, you're dumping energy into the system. It can heat up. The couplings via optical phonons, these take up the excess energy. In fiber, it has an ultra-fast response. It's the order of a few femtoseconds. The big advantage is that the gain can be anywhere. Anywhere that the fiber transmits any wavelength, you'll have gain. The only thing is you need a pump for it, and so the pump will supply the pump at this wavelength, and, of course, then the maximum Raman gain will be offset here by about 440 wave numbers in silicon. The peak gain is about 10 to the minus 13 meters per watt. And the gain can be cascaded. So once you've generated the first Stokes, you can use the radiation here to generate the second Stokes, third Stokes, and carry on the whole way up until you run out of power. The gain is shifted by about 13 terahertz. It's about 40 terahertz broad, so that means you could definitely can support femtosecond pulses. It's polarization dependent, so as you could imagine, if you have some sort of vibration, if you're going at right angles, you're not going to get much gain in that. And it's material dependent. Of course, it's material dependent. Everyone knows that. If you look at the main dopants that would go into fiber, this is silica here, silica dioxide. Germanium dioxide has about an order of magnitude increase in the Raman gain. But if you remember, germanium's the next one in the series. This is a lot bigger. So the scattering of germanium is a lot higher. So if you make a germanium fiber, the loss can be a lot higher in germanium. Phosphorus has a shifted peak. It's interesting that germanium and silica, their sort of peak gain lie roughly around the same shift. And this is boron oxide. If you look at the power that you need to get sufficient Raman gain, this is the power for threshold. It's essentially just the area, 16A over GL, where this is sort of, this is like a power times the gain times the length divided by the area. So the power density times the length has to equal about 16. That's all that's saying. If you stick this into the sort of equation, just looking at the normal gain, so it's an exponential gain, the power, power density times the length. This is the gain coefficient. Of course, you have to take away the loss of the Stokes. And when you're considering the length, you also have to consider the gain length. For example, this could be if you're running CW, it's the loss length. If you're running with, say, pulses, it's the length it takes for, say, the first Stokes and the fundamental to walk off each other. So if you're typically talking, say, around 1 micron with 100 second pulses, at 106, your first Raman will be about 1.12. It'll walk off after about 60 meters. So really, that is your effective gain length. Once the pulses have walked apart, you aren't going to get any more gain. But if you look at this CW, you put in typical numbers, For 20 dB of gain, you roughly require over 20 kilometers in a CW system. You require about 300 milliwatts, which is actually quite modest. And what does it look like? This is what it looks like. This is a classic, well, 1 micron pump system where you have the first stokes, 1.12, second stokes, 1.18, 2.4. And then, as I mentioned on Monday night, this is this soliton Raman continuum that confused them all for quite a few years. In the visible, it's totally different. You've no anomalous dispersion here. This is anomalously dispersed. This is normal. This is normal all the way up. So in the visible, it just cascades, keeps on cascading, until it essentially runs out of power. It can't do any more pumping, and you get no more Raman. But you can see you can generate essentially the full spectrum here, starting from the green. Okay, so what happens then if you add this little bit of dispersion with a bit of nonlinearity? And this brings us on to quite an important topic, which is very important for supercontinuum generation. If you go back to your intensity, you have your sweep here due to self-phase modulation. So the front of the pulse is downshifted, so it's red. The back end of the pulse is blue, it's upshifted. So if you put this into a system that is normally dispersive, in the normal dispersion regime, the red component travels faster than the blue. So the front end of the pulse will move off a lot faster than the back end, so you'll have dispersion. So the pulse will broaden. If you go into the anomalous dispersion regime, however, the front end of the pulse is actually traveling slower now than the back end, so the back end begins to catch up. And that's the concept of the optical soliton. It's the balance between the self-phase modulation and dispersion. So in the normal regime, you have total broadening, no compression at all. If you have anomalous dispersion, you can see that you can get compression. But as this gets compressed, it increases its intensity, so it tries to increase its bandwidth. So it's sort of increasing its bandwidth. There's more bandwidth. It tries to compress more. So you can see you probably reach, even just naively, you can reach this situation where with a certain power, you'll reach a balance between the dispersion and the nonlinearity. And that's the soliton. And the power required to generate this soliton is roughly proportional to the dispersion divided by the duration of the pulse. Or in fact, the power of the pulse duration is the dispersion divided by the energy. Now, the idea of solitons is definitely not new. Sid mentioned that. The first solitons were proposed in optical fiber by Hasegawa and Tappert in 1973. It was first realized by Lynn Molinar in 1980 at Bell Labs. But the first solitons were actually proposed by this guy in the UK, Scott Russell, in Edinburgh. And he was lucky. He these guys in the UK at that time who was from a family who had money. He was a very rich guy, and so he could choose to do whatever he wanted. But he wasn't the typical numbskull British guy. He actually was a mathematician as well. So he spent his time doing a bit of mathematics. And this is actually taken, I've transcribed this from his paper, which was presented at the 14th British Association for the Advancement of Science in York. And it's the proceedings. I got this through the British Library. And it's actually nice to read it. Just to read the introduction, it actually reads terrific. If you compared to this with what you'd write in a present-day paper. So I'll read it to you very quickly. It says, "I was observing the motion of a boat which was rapidly drawn along a narrow channel by a pair of horses." He doesn't say what color the horses were, by the way. So, "when the boat suddenly stopped, not so the mass of water in the channel which it had put in motion. It accumulated around the prow, the front of the vessel, in a state of violent agitation. Then suddenly, leaving it behind, rolled forward with great velocity, assuming the form of a large solitary elevation, a rounded, smooth, and well-defined heap of water, which continued its course along the channel, apparently without change or form or diminution of speed. I followed it on horseback, and observed it still rolling at a rate of some 8 or 9 miles an hour. He was travelling quite okay on the horse, preserving its original figure, some 30 feet long and a foot to a foot and a half in height. Its height gradually diminished, and after a chase of 1 or 2 miles, I lost it in the windings of the channel. Such, in the month of August 1843, was my first chance interview with that singular and beautiful phenomenon which I have called the wave of translation. So the wave of translation was this solitary wave on top of water. And the non-linearity, of course, with the soliton in water is that its speed depends on the height. So the height of the wave determines its speed. And that's the non-linear bit. So the question is, I wonder if there was any other observations of solitons before that. Well, I actually think that there probably was. If you look at this, this is a very famous print. I'm sure everyone has seen it. This is Hokusai, and it's called The Great Wave, and it's part of a series of 36 views of Mount Fuji. This is Mount Fuji here in the background. Here, this is the Great Wave. In actual fact, this is a breaking wave. So this is the wave where the top is traveling very, very fast, much faster than the bits below it. So it rolls over, and this is a breaking wave. But this bit here, actually just lying in front of the breaking wave, that's actually a soliton. So in actual fact, Hokusai probably has the first recorded experimental evidence of a soliton. So the thing about Scott Russell was that he actually went home and did the mathematics. Hokusai just went home and made a drawing. You know? he should have been employed at Imperial College. Okay, so if you begin to look at the description of the soliton, and this is done through this nonlinear Schrodinger equation, and there's a lot of aggravation about this, that the mathematicians say that this is the pure soliton equation. Once you start in it, adding any other terms, it's not solitons anymore. You know, there's a lot of sort of pretension about it. So this is simply the intensity dependent term. This is actually the nonlinearity, and this is the envelope propagation. And if you look at this, and as Hasegawa said, if the absorption is small and the nonlinear term can be made comparable to the dispersion term, then you get this solution, which has this typical Sech-like profile. N is some sort of integer, and N is simply this balance between the nonlinear length and the dispersive length. Well, the dispersive length is just the tau squared over the beta, and the nonlinear length is 1 over gamma p. Part. And you're just balancing these two effects. This gives you the sort of number in engineering terms of what the required power is. Basically, it's these fixed terms. This simply comes because of the shape of the pulse, the effective area of the pulse, wavelength, group delay, dispersion, duration, nonlinear refractive index, and speed of light. And if you stick conventional numbers into this, fairly big dispersion, 1 picosecond pulse. The soliton period, actually the period required to develop, is about 20 meters. So if you have less than 20 meters, you can't really say you have a soliton if you want 1 picosecond pulse at 1.5. The soliton power required is about 30 watts, but at 100 megahertz, that's relatively low. You only need about 3 milliwatts average power. Hasegawa, to his credit, had predicted 90 milliwatts, which is actually pretty good, very good. And he, at the time, he wrote a rather, I think I mentioned this the other night, a rather modest power and well within the capabilities of most available lasers. I don't know where he was thinking, because there were just a couple of problems with that. There was two very minor problems in 1973. There was no picosecond sources and no low-loss fiber. So it was a kind of serious problem at that stage to develop solitons. And it was only in 1970 that the guys out of Corning, John Keck, actually demonstrated, and people were delighted to get a low-loss fiber of 17 dB per kilometer. This showed that telecom was the future. This showed that this was going to happen, and that with purification of the glass, and simply using pure silica, nothing else, pure silica. So So this just shows you what the convention or what you need if you're going to develop fifth femtosecond pulses at various repetition rates. But the thing to get away is that at sort of typical rates that you would have in a laser system, the powers are modest. Tens of milliwatts for even generating 100 femtosecond solitons. Hasegawa, when he realized you couldn't do bright solitons, along with Tappert, then actually thought, well, Satsuma and Nijima investigated what happened if you just sort of input this function into an optical fiber. And what actually happened to the soliton or the pulse that you actually launched. And they actually showed that, in fact, it was very, very forgiving. That, in fact, the amplitude of the pulse launched could vary over quite a large range. And that this could actually vary between 0.5 and 1.5, and you'd still generate a single soliton. So in actual fact, it was easy, relatively easy. You didn't have to be so precise in what you launched into the system. If you launched actually above that, so rather than getting a single soliton, you get a two-soliton state. And these two solitons, of course, could phase interfere with each other. When you had the situation where this A was equal to N, which is a... Somebody's calling you through the fiber there. when A equals an integer, the pulse... What actually happens with the solitons when they're high order? They actually demonstrate this phase interference. So as it propagates along, you'll have the pulse of high intensity. It'll break up, split into two pulses, propagate along, combine again, and it'll continuously do that periodically. And it'll do that, breathe, as it's called, and recover itself over this so-called soliton period. And the soliton period is simply effectively related to the pulse duration. You can see the longer the pulse duration, the longer the soliton period. When you have these higher order solitons, in fact, you can get a compression as through the phase interference. So, and that is actually given by roughly four times n. So if you have a pulse that is, this is the n that determines the power. So say you had a pulse here that was 100 times the soliton power, n would be 10. So you'd have a pulse compression of a factor of 41, in fact, as it propagates down the fiber. So if you had launched a power then that was 10 times 1 picosecond, you put it into a fiber, it'll compress a factor of 40, roughly down to 25 femtoseconds. And the first experiments in that were very, very simply done. This is Molinar's source of very beautiful pulses. They were transform limited. They were perfect tunable pulses using various sources. And the fiber was a single piece of fiber. The one thing they couldn't do in the early days is they couldn't cut the fiber. It was so precious that in actual fact it was a disaster to cut the fiber because you couldn't fuse it back together again. That wasn't happening in 1980. Once it was cut, it was lost. That was the end of it. So they kept a fixed length of fiber that they knew was roughly half a soliton period. And so they realized that you could, if you launched the adequate power in, you should see shortening over that period. This is what happened. They launched the power. When the power was below the soliton power of n equals 1, the fundamental soliton, you can see that the pulse broadened. When it was n equals 1, it was narrower, and this is roughly about a factor of 4. They increased the power now by a factor of up to 5 watts, roughly 4 times this, so it's roughly n equals 2. And you can see pulse narrowing. You can see that there's shoulders on this. Now, I don't have time to explain autocorrelation. Basically, an autocorrelation is just a measurement of a pulse against itself. It's a technique of measuring. It's a nonlinear technique. You measure the second harmonic of the intensities, you scan them across each other, and you can see when the pulses overlap, you'll get more intensity in the middle. And you can see that if you have one pulse, it just essentially scribes through itself, and that's the autocorrelation. If you have N equals 3 soliton, then you should expect to see essentially 5 peaks in the autocorrelation, which you do, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. N equals 4, well, the resolution is so low here that you actually can't see all the peaks in it. But clearly you can see narrowing as you get down and increasing the number of solitons increases. So it all agreed relatively well with the theory that Jim Gordon had developed. And this is this higher order soliton breathing that you see. This is it in the temporal domain. You go in with a relatively long pulse. You see it beginning to decrease. Now, one of the functions or one of the characteristics of a soliton is that its area is preserved. So as you squeeze it up in time, its intensity has to increase. So you can see here that as the pulse begins to squeeze down in time, it decreases, increases in height, decreases in duration. Then it begins to breathe more, splits into the two solitons. The two solitons then propagate roughly for about half a soliton period, begin to combine again, narrow pulse, and it breathes back then after the full soliton length back to the input duration. And of course, spectrally, it has to correspond. As the pulse begins to narrow, it spectrally has to increase. You can't sort of overcome the transform them. And this is just a repeat of it. This shows the experimental measurement of this, and all it is just some sort of, it's not as good of evidence. This is a very, very early measurement, so it's not as good as the theoretical prediction. But the extreme soliton compression is clearly seen in this, and this is a 300-meter fiber, and as you increase the soliton number, 3, 5, 7, 13, so roughly you're going to expect a compression here of a factor of 50. You're putting a one and a half picosecond pulse in. You'd roughly then expect out 300 femtoseconds, 0.3 picoseconds coming out. So everything's sort of working. The numbers are roughly okay. And this was 1983. So the sort of breathing that was happening was well controlled and understood. The other thing, of course, is, as I've explained, solitons actually do interfere with each other. They have long-range interaction. And this was first observed, once again, using the soliton source by the people at Bell Labs. It had been predicted by Cartman in 1981. And this actually shows you a measurement of how solitons interfere. You essentially have a Michelson interferometer. So the arms of this can be set with a fixed distance between them. So remember now you have two pulses. If you measure them in before they go in and measure them before they come out using an autocorrelation, well, before they go in the autocorrelation, it's two pulses. So as you take the autocorrelation, you'll have two sort of signals. Then as they overlap, it increases intensity. So you'll have this big central peak. And then when they're sitting apart, you'll still have an autocorrelation, but it's reduced. So this is the three peaks that you'll get in the autocorrelation. So two as they sit, one as they overlap, then two as they separate again as you scan through. And this can be scanned through using this movable mirror. And you can set them to whatever you want. And they're set to this sort of separation at the input. And now you adjust this just finely. So as you're changing the phase over essentially a wavelength, when they're in phase, you can see that the pulses collapse. They fuse together. When they're out of phase, they push apart. Now, if you are actually predicting what would happen without any interaction, they should just follow this linear line. What goes in comes out. And you can see if they're very, very far apart, then it's roughly happening. As they get closer, then when they're actually in phase, you see this collapse. So it very rapidly collapses, so they fuse together very quickly. It's meant to oscillate, but unfortunately it didn't. They just fly apart after that. Here then, when they're out of phase, you can see that as they get closer, then you can see the repulsion, and they push apart. And it's moderately easy to understand why, say, for example, that they do, if you think of it, if you have two pulses, sitting like this, and this is in time. The front end's red, the back end's blue. This one here, the front end's red and the back end's blue. If you bring them together and they're in phase, so their intensity is going to increase in the center. It's going to add. So as their intensity increases, the back end of this pulse is now going to become, it's not going to become as blue, it's going to become redder. So you're in the anomalous dispersion regime where red travels slower, so it's going to fall back in time. So it's as if the front end of this pulse is going to fall back in on that one. And the inverse happens on the trailing pulse. It becomes bluer and speeds up and runs in, so they both meld together. And that's an easy way to look at it. Of course, it's slightly wrong to think of it like that because solitons aren't chirp. They actually don't have any frequency chirp across them. They have a fixed phase. But you have to use some sort of analogy to think of these things, and that sort of hopefully explains it. So the properties of fundamental solitons are, they're extremely robust. That's the one thing that you must take from this. The power doesn't have to be an exact solid. In fact, anything will form a soliton, anything at all. You can put in a sinusoidal wave and it'll turn into a soliton. And we'll see that later how, in fact, anything does turn into a soliton. And all it does is it just readjusts itself into an N equals soliton. It takes some time and propagation in the fiber to do it, but it'll turn into a soliton. They're actually very insensitive to fast perturbations. So, for example, if you are going in a system with a soliton and suddenly there's a change in the dispersion over a relatively short length, it doesn't notice it. It just bloop through it and goes and just forgets about it. As long as the length of the perturbation isn't comparable to the soliton period, which is this period of extreme. And in fact, you can do the same with gain. So if you are propagating a soliton and you go through a very short length of gain, you can whop up its intensity very quickly. It'll still maintain its set profile. Unfortunately, once it then comes out of that and hits the fiber after that, it'll try to adjust. But you can, if you do that periodically, you can actually end up in the situation where if everything is relatively short, you act in this average soliton regime. And all it does is it takes on the sort of performance of an average soliton. It just sees the average dispersion, it sees the average gain, and there, as long as the perturbation period is short and the amplification period is short compared to the soliton period. Of course, as I say, the soliton area is conserved, and this is the sort of good approximation also to hold in your head for the soliton length, but this is only for 1.5 microns. Roughly, it's about a quarter of T squared over D, where this is in picoseconds and this is in picoseconds per nanometer kilometer. So solitons then can be relaunched, and this is actually just showing you what happens if you do have a pulse, 100 femtosecond pulse, and it's not a perfect soliton. So it has a bit of phase noise on it or there's an excess chirp on it. What actually happens is within a relatively short period, roughly the soliton period here is going to be of the order of about a meter, a couple of meters for femtosecond pulse. So within a few meters, this begins to readjust itself. You can see here, this is up to about 2 meters. It's by 3 meters, it's changed its duration to about 400 femtoseconds. Keeps on going, and after about 30 meters, it's more or less stabilized and propagates then as a picosecond pulse. So it just readjusts itself, takes what it needs from the bandwidth and the energy it has, sheds off the bit it doesn't need, and propagates then continuously as a nice, steady soliton. So I think perhaps that's probably a good place to end, and I'll continue then after the break. As I say, I've run over by about 3 minutes. If anyone wants to ask me a question at any time, please feel free. Okay, thanks very much.